Hello and welcome to Global Eye. I'm Parikshit Luthra. The ongoing conflict between Israel and Hamas is feared to escalate into a regional crisis. Iran has threatened to attack Israel after an attack on an Iranian consular building in Syria earlier this month. Killed 11 people, including two Iranian generals. Responding to Iran's warning, Israel said it is prepared for any attack and will retaliate directly to any provocation from Iran. The U.S. is also trying to deter Iran from carrying out retaliatory strikes. The White House has said that support to Israel's security is ironclad. The U.S. has restricted movement of its diplomats in Israel amid fears of an attack. France has evacuated family members of French diplomats from Iran and warned citizens against traveling to Iran in the coming days. India's foreign ministry, too, has advised citizens against traveling to Iran and Israel until further notice as the world anticipates Iran's next move. Meanwhile, Israel is allowing aid into Gaza after international pressure grew to ease the humanitarian crisis. The first batch of trucks have entered the battered enclave via the newly opened crossing point in the north of Gaza.
We are prepared both defensively and offensively in a variety of capacities of the army. An attack from Iran's territory will be solid proof of Iran's intention to escalate in the Middle East and stop hiding behind its proxies.
We have made very clear, obviously we've seen the threats coming from Iran, and so we have made ourselves very clear where we stand in supporting Israel's security. That is ironclad. That does not change. I'm just not going to get into details about our operational procedures from here.
Now, to take this discussion forward is Trita Parsi, Executive Vice President at the Quincy Institute for Responsible Statecraft, someone who is an expert on Middle East and Iranian affairs. Dr. Parsi, let me begin by asking you about the basis for the immediate intelligence about an attack, about a retaliatory attack from Iran. There seems to be a lot of fear among Western countries right now.
There certainly is a lot of fear in Western countries because intelligence has been picked up that, unlike previous attacks by Israeli forces against Iranian targets in Lebanon or in Syria, this time around, the Iranians appear to be planning to retaliate. What is fundamentally problematic about the Biden administration's approach, as well as that of the United Kingdom, is that all of the pressure is on Iran not to respond, combined with essentially zero pressure on Israel not to provoke in the first place. Mindful of the fact that the attack against the consulate was a flagrant violation of international law and the Vienna Convention. And this was also done by the Israelis without any heads up to the United States, despite the fact that the attack also puts U.S. troops in danger.
How do you think, and what are the options before Iran in terms of attacking Israel directly or having an equal response, a proportionate response by attacking any of the Israeli consulates?
So I think what the Israelis are messaging here is that they will view an attack from Iranian soil as escalatory. And the only attack from Iranian soil that could reach Israel would be an attack using ballistic missile. The implicit message of the Israelis may be that if the Iranians respond through drones or through militias from Syrian or Lebanese or other territories, the Israelis will likely respond in some kind, but not in a way to further escalate the situation. Because the emphasis has been that the attack would be escalatory from the Israeli perspective if it is originating from Iran. And the only thing they really could mean in that terms is that if the Iranians are using ballistic missiles. Iran's options at the end of the day are limited because it doesn't have an air force in the same manner, of course, that the Israelis do. Its only way of reaching Israel proper is through ballistic missiles.
Right. I would also like to ask you about Iran's strategy, especially does Iran intend to directly carry out an attack without any kind of preconditions, maybe cause escalation in the Middle East? Or do you feel that there would be some preconditions in back-channel talks with the United States and the Western powers because of which it may avoid a direct confrontation with Israel?
There are reports in the Arab press that have not been confirmed that part of the communication between the United States and Iran has been that the Iranians have indicated that if the United States presses Israel for a ceasefire in Gaza, which, of course, in the course of the last 6 months, the Biden administration has refused to do, but that if Biden does this and secures a ceasefire, the Iranians may refrain from retaliating against this flagrant violation of international law that was the attack on the consulate in Damascus. But there's no indication from the Biden administration that they would entertain such an option. So whatever way out the Iranians have offered, if this reporting is true, appears to have been rejected by the Biden administration.
Right. I would also like to ask you about the threat of a larger escalation. In case Iran does attack Israel in any form, who are the countries which could directly get involved?
Unfortunately, most of the region is fearing that such a clash will spill over in many different parts. So, for instance, you mentioned earlier on that the Iranians might, instead of attacking Israel, may do a proportionate attack by targeting one of Israel's embassies or consulates in the region. One such consulate could be the one in Jordan or embassy. But Jordan is already on the brink of collapse because of the population's fury with what the Israelis are doing in Gaza and their perception that the Jordanian government is not doing enough to put pressure to end the massacres in Gaza. So an attack by Iran on the embassy in Jordan could have significant spillover and destabilizing effects for Jordan. If the Iranians were to target other embassies in the region, it would also risk straining their relationship with those countries at a moment in which the Iranians are actually trying to improve their relations with their Arab neighbors and, frankly, are benefiting from the fact that the Israelis are doing so much to undermine their own relationship, not just with the Arab world, but with the global South as a whole.
Right. Dr. Parsi, do you think Israel, by carrying out this attack on the Israeli consulate in Syria, has actually left with Iran with any option but to retaliate? Do you think Iran will be forced to attack because of what has happened, because of the credibility of the country being at stake?
It appears as if the Israelis wanted to push the Iranians into a corner and force them to respond, because the Israelis knew very well that the Iranian red line was an attack on Iranian territory. The consulate in Damascus is technically Iranian territory. And this goes to a larger problem that the Biden administration's approach to this conflict has, which is that they have essentially tied themselves to the Netanyahu government's approach. But Netanyahu is not looking to end the conflict. Netanyahu benefits not only from prolonging the conflict, but also enlarging the conflict, because Netanyahu knows very well that the minute this conflict ends, so does his political career. And potentially, that's also the moment where his prison sentence will begin, mindful of the corruption charges that have been filed against him. And this is part of the problem of the Biden administration not pursuing an independent policy, but supporting Netanyahu, even though Netanyahu appears to have very different goals than the Biden administration.
Right. Dr. Parsi, also asking you, why is the United States not going all out to stop Netanyahu right now? If there is an escalation, a war in the Middle East, who does it really benefit at this juncture? U.S. is going to elections. Yes, there is overwhelming support within the electorate, also in political circles in the United States, to continue supporting Israel against the Hamas, to continue supporting Netanyahu. But what are the stakes if there is a large-scale war in the Middle East?
This would be an absolute disaster for the region, but also for the United States. And certainly for Biden's re-election bid, he has already hurt himself tremendously with key constituencies, African-Americans, younger voters, Arab-American voters in key states, that very well may end up causing him to lose the election, despite other aspects of his record that are quite favorable to his re-election. And for now, it's for him to continue to sow blindly, as he said, ironclad, support Israel, even when the Israelis are deliberately moving the region towards a regional war, is frankly inexcusable, because it seems to have been a decision that Biden has been making without any consideration of what the implications are, not just for U.S. interests, but also for many other countries in the world who have a very strong defense relationship with the United States and who benefit from a strong America on the global stage. Biden has done a tremendous amount to undermine America's global standing in the last 6 months, despite the fact that when he came into office, part of his platform was to restore American standing in the world following what Trump had done. And to a large extent, he had been successful in doing so. But he himself has unraveled that in the last 6 months with the decisions he had made.
Right. I want to ask you, what are some of the economic toolkits that Iran has at its disposal right now? There is a larger fear that in case the war escalates in the Middle East, more countries get involved, we're going to go see a lot of volatility in oil prices, which could spike, hurt the global economy. How will countries in the region, especially India, get affected? We are going to be badly affected by inflation, by oil prices, if things go south in the Middle East. And Iran is a close partner, a close ally of India as well. How do you think a country like India is likely to impact it?
India benefits from stability and tranquility in the Middle East and on the oil markets. We have already seen how the war in Ukraine has had an impact on India's oil flows. And even if India has shifted much of its oil purchases to Russia, it will nevertheless be affected by this, because if oil prices go up, which they will do, not only if there's a war, but also if there's just an increase in tension, that will also impact the oil prices that Russia will use when it is selling its oil to India. So India will be very directly affected by the economic fallout, but it may also be affected in other ways, given the very large number of the Indian diaspora working in several Arab countries in the Persian Gulf and their ability to continue to do so if the regional security situation unravels. Again, this is profoundly dangerous, but it is also eminently avoidable. We don't have to go in this direction. There's absolutely nothing about this that is inevitable. But unfortunately, as long as the United States and Biden refuses to also put pressure on Israel to make sure that Israel restrains itself, that Israel does not escalate the situation, then unfortunately, we will continue to move in the direction of tremendous instability.
All right. Thank you very much, Dr. Parsi, for joining us on the program. Definitely a very worrying situation, and India could be directly impacted by any escalation in the Middle East, as you're pointing out. We'll have to leave it there, but thank you for joining us. We're heading into a short break, but coming up on the other side, the U.S. this week hosted a trilateral summit with Japan and Philippines, and the big focus was China. President Biden vowed to defend Philippines from any attacks in South China Sea. A discussion with Ambassador Ashok Kanta, our former envoy to China, when we return.